Thank you, Leslie. Good morning. Welcome to our worship service. Whether you're here in person on this turbulent morning or enjoying worship from the comfort of your home, would you please rise with me as we begin our worship in song? Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are all who come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. What a mighty God we serve indeed. Father, we give you thanks and praise for choosing us to gather closer to you this morning, in both person and online. Let our praise and worship be worthy of your love and grace. Let your spirit move us. Your word fill us with peace, which passes understanding, so that we may be a shining light unto the world and all can see the beauty and glory of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Stars of night.
as we are enjoying our special music virtually this morning. Here is 10,000 Reasons. Announcements this morning. Be sure to check out our church's YouTube channel, the Cuba United Methodist Church. Trustees will have a meeting Monday at 6 p.m. The Cuba UMC men are having a mastacholi and a meeting on Sunday the 23rd, so all men are welcome to attend there in a fellowship hall at 3 p.m. Next year is going to be our sesquicentennial anniversary of being the United Methodist Church in Cuba. Please contact Jenny Gross or the office for any additional information or email cumc150@att.net. There's a tentative meeting scheduled for May 20th. In celebration of Mother's Day, we will have a flower for each of our mothers. The ushers will pass them out at the end of service. Thank you to all the mothers out there for all of your love and support. We know we wouldn't be here without you. We are again collecting your spare change or donations you have for the Lifeline Pregnancy Care Center. Their baby bottles are out on the table in the narthex. If you would use those to collect them and then bring them back on Father's Day. And I believe we have a little video to watch.
What would you do if a life depended on you? When a human life is on the line, we go to great expense and willingly risk everything. God has placed within us the courage to go to heroic lengths to defend the weakest among us. Why? Because human life is made by God in His own image. It is precious and eternal, worth more than anything else on earth. And when a helpless life is threatened, it is worth defending. With the collapse of family and moral values, the most defenseless, the most helpless in our society is the unborn. Mothers have been convinced that abortion is their only choice. Fathers have been stripped of their right to protect their own children. Who will stand to defend the unborn? Who will speak God's truth into the brokenness and confusion? At the Pregnancy Clinic, we are taking the time to listen, the time to train, the time to be there when a frightened new mom doesn't know what to do. We tell confused parents the truth in love, showing them the life that is growing inside. We are there until and even after their baby is born. We stand on God's amazing promises and help prepare them for a better life, giving many the first glimpse of the love and forgiveness that God offers.
While I was doing nothing, a battle was raging and lives were being lost. I knew I had to do something. By giving up my time and resources, I am now standing for what I believe. Nothing could feel better than knowing I helped to save an innocent life.
While you may never have the chance to save someone from a burning building, you can help more than you imagine. What will you do to defend a life? Join us today, because every life is worth defending.
Cuba UMC quilters are being showcased at the museum during the month of May with their own hand-quilted quilts. The quilts are now are in the new quilters room. To see the quilts, the museum is open Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday from 10 to 2. Be sure to ask Pat and Lila to get a private tour. Joys and concerns this week. We are very joyful to celebrate birthdays. On the 10th is Jane Reed and Jim Trippensey. The 11th is Tina Sanders. The 12th is Dean Garrick. The 14th is Bailey Elliott and Billy Arnold. Are there any other joys you'd like to share? Where have you seen God this week? Kim? Kim's grateful to enjoy time with her son, Aaron.
My grandson, Alex, graduated last night from dental school.
So Joyce's grandson graduated from dental school. That's definitely a big joy and a big relief, I'm sure, for him, for all the seniors graduating this year. Cheryl?
I have a prayer request from Lawrence Reed. For Beverly Haynes.
Are there other prayer requests we'd like to bring forward? For the family of Dan Horner and the loss of his wife. For Kim Holland, who's going through some medical issues. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, even when your path takes us through the valley of deepest darkness, fear will never conquer us, for you have already conquered all fear. Your authority is our strength and peace. The comfort of your love takes away all of our fear. We will never be lonely, for you will not forsake us, and you are always near. God, for all the people present and all those watching, whoever two or more gathered, you are near. Whatever circumstances and trials surround us, Lord, you surround those circumstances. We lean into your perfect love, which casts out all fears. God, we know you have gone before us, carving a path through the valley where the shadow of sickness, death loom. You have created a path upon the mountain where in glorious brightness of your presence, fear cannot exist. Not only do you create the path before us, but you cover our journey from behind. Father, we are always surrounded by your Holy Spirit, surrounded by your love, your peace. And so today we are asking a blessing on Dan, the Horner family, on Lawrence, and on Kim Holland, and all of those unspoken prayer requests troubling your children. For you, God, are faithful and hear the cries of your children. As servants trusting and obeying a faithful God, we pray as our Lord and Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Travis. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
And happy Mother's Day. So good to see you all. I've often called Mother's Day the third high holy day in the Christian year, because you have, of course, Christmas Eve, you have Easter, and right after that, Mother's Day, and that's for a good reason. It used to be that it would be the time, and I hope that the tradition continues, that's when mothers and grandmothers or anyone that sort of resembles a mother in sense of the unconditional love of motherhood, the ideal. That's what we really celebrate, I guess you could put it that way, that the mothers represent the unconditional, the patient, the ever hopeful love of God. So in that sense, we're all mothers. In that sense, we all try to emulate that amazing love that bonds us together through God. That's why we usually do our best not to refer to God in any gender. And that is because of the love that infuses, transcends human understanding. But if we are going to put a gender on God, I think we ought to do it like a mother, because it is a beautiful image. I am in a series of sermons that uses a less austere image for God: dogs. And that's what I'm going to continue the series on, with how our canine friends can sort of reveal to us the characteristics of our Creator, and of course how we may live with each other in that type of love dogs show us. So before I go in today's sermon, let us pray. Lord our God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to worship wherever we may be worshiping, whether it's here or online. Thank you for showing us what love is all about. Amen. Now, if you're like me, occasionally you will see on a telephone pole or a light pole a sign that says "lost dog," and then there's a picture of Muffy or Mr. Biff or whoever that is, with reward. And I saw one sign that said, "Lost dog, no reward. You find him, you keep him." I think they were being a bit facetious, but lost dogs are a reality of life, aren't they? Because either dogs lose us or we lose them, and usually it's on their initiative. If you haven't read the Upper Room Devotional, I'd encourage you to do that. That's from the United Methodist Church Board of Discipleship, and you can get it online. Go and find how you can get a devotion sent to you every day in email. A few years ago, I was reading that, and I read about Tim Burleson, a man in North Carolina, who had this to say. Sadie, our six-month-old black Labrador puppy, has more energy than I do and can run faster than I can. And the other day, she got loose and took off running. I could not outrun her, so I walked after her. Sadie led me on a wild goose chase through our neighborhood. She kept looking back and changing direction for some 20 minutes as I steadily followed. Finally, Sadie ran into a corner and could not escape me. So she headed back to me with a look in her eyes that said, "I'm sorry, do you still love me?" And I will admit that if I were Tim, I would respond to that dog, "Let me think about it." Isn't it the most exasperating thing? You know, I would feel, and as our dogs have gone off, I do feel like that stereotypical mom. "I care for you. I put clothes on your back. I feed you. I take care of you, and this is what I get in return." Yeah, it's what you get in return. And it would just frustrate me to no end. How can the dog do that to me? Just go out. Well, the obvious response is that Sadie, or any dog that leaves us, doesn't do it to us. Sadie is just being Sadie. Sadie just does what a dog does. And we sometimes just take it personally, don't we? I think that, this is an aside on the sermon, I just think we could lower our blood pressure quite a bit if we realize that when we get angry at someone for what they've done to us, they really haven't done it to us. They are just being themselves, and we happen to be in their way. We sort of take it onto ourselves and we get upset. It would lower our blood pressure if we could give them the grace that we should give Sadie. Sadie's just doing what Sadie does. Sadie is now feeling, without a leash, she can take off. She can run, and she's always wanted to run. Now she can. And she smells these amazing aromas. Don't you love the dogs with their heads out the window? All sorts of things they're imagining. Well, now Sadie can do that, can just follow her nose, or she can frolic with a new friend she's made. She's free. It is great. And she continued going on down. Sure, the master is walking after her, but she at this point doesn't care because freedom is so good, isn't it? And I think we humans can relate. Because sometimes we're off that leash, and it is wonderful. Like for that man who's a husband and a father. And at the office, there's this co-worker who is expressing some interest in him, and she starts making him feel younger. Or there's that teenager that's at that party, and there's that little pill that's being offered her. I wonder what that would do. Or there's that woman who has made it up the corporate ladder and is in a position usually held by men. And she knows that to keep that position, she's going to have to bend some values and ethics of hers. Or there's that person who's discovered that a little drink can help with a big problem, so what will a lot of drinking do? Or. Get the idea? We always have that opportunity to be Sadie, and that is so exciting. And Sadie, like us at times, forgets the consequences, doesn't see the long term. After Sadie is wandering around, after an hour or two, she would think, I'm hungry, where's Master? Or, you know, it's starting to rain, I'm glad I am, wait a second, this isn't home. You just continue the thought, and Sadie ends up in a corner. Or sometimes people end up in trees. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through town. A man there named Zacchaeus, a ruler among tax collectors, was rich. He was trying to see Jesus, who Jesus was, but being a short man, he couldn't because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed up a sycamore tree so he could see Jesus, who was about to pass that way. Why was he in a sycamore tree? More importantly, why was he a tax collector? Because you probably know from past Bible studies or sermons, being a tax collector was not really a preferred job. No, you were pretty much considered the scum of the earth if you were a tax collector. Why? Because you were a toady of the Roman government. Rome said, you must pay you people in Israel, Jews, you need to pay us taxes. And here are fellow Jews that we will pay to collect your taxes. And these tax collectors, what's more, once they extract from you what we demand, they can charge you commission. It was totally up to these traitors, as tax collectors were seen. It was totally up to them whatever they wanted to charge. And a ruler of the tax collectors, often called the chief tax collector, was the top of the pyramid scheme. He was the one who enlisted all of these lesser tax collectors to rob their fellow citizens. And he would get a cut of the action from each and every one. What in the world would possess a man to say, oh, I really want to be a tax collector when I grow up? What? What is it? I don't know. But I would have a hunch that it was sort of, you know, I really don't need other people, do I? What I need is to rely on my own skill, my own business sense, my ability to take care of myself. So I'm going to make my money. I'm going to build me a big house. I'm going to guard it with dogs. I'm going to do all of that. I really don't need to be that respected, do I? What I need is to make it on my own. I'm guessing that's why Zacchaeus or anybody else would be a tax collector. Love of money, love of being able to be independent and self-assured. And look what I've done. I don't know. But I do know that being up a tree, a sycamore tree, to see Jesus, there must have been a reason for that. Because ordinarily he's too busy, tax collectors, getting money and figuring the next scheme to be worrying about this itinerant ex-carpenter rabbi who is wandering around. But maybe he was intrigued because he heard that Jesus was not this typical religious figure. All the religious figures he knew were the ones who said, you must obey 613 laws to be accepted by God and one another. Those are 613 laws the Pharisees saw in the Old Testament. That's what you must do to be accepted by God. And he sort of rebelled against that. It's like, oh, you're not going to tell me what to do. But maybe he was just tired. Maybe he was just tired of chasing some dream that really now was turning out to be a nightmare. Because he remembered what it was like to be in the synagogue. He remembered what it was like to hear, what does the Lord require of you, O man, but to do justice and love mercy and walk humbly with your God. He heard all the stories about God hearing the cries of those who were poor and oppressed. He remembered all of that, but he had put that all back. But now, he heard that Jesus was saying something else, something that was a little more attractive, something called grace. And you know what else he heard? He heard that Jesus was criticized by these very same religious people. Why was he criticized? Because, and this is a great line, because Jesus was known to have eaten and have drunk with sinners and tax collectors. That's key. That's radical. Because that was his big criticism from the Pharisees, who said, you must abide by 613 laws. No. Their thing with Jesus was, he is hanging out with the people who do not follow the 613 laws and tax collectors. Maybe Zacchaeus had heard that. Who in the world, in the name of Yahweh, would say such, would hang out with us? And so he goes up to the sycamore. He's up a tree. He's in that corner. When Jesus came to that spot under the sycamore tree, he looked up and said, Zacchaeus, come down at once. I must stay in your house today. And Zacchaeus fell out of the tree. That's my paraphrase. But think about that. Everybody in the crowd wanted Jesus to go to their home. It's a rock star. Think of your favorite celebrity, whoever that is. And imagine that you got a text or a call saying, can I come over today? I'd love to talk with you. What would you do? Ah, you'd fall out of a tree. Zacchaeus basically, well, technically, he said, so Zacchaeus came down at once, happy, blessed, joyful, beside himself to welcome Jesus. Everyone who saw this grumbled. Just love those grumbling people. He has gone to be the guest of a sinner. Which was, I wanted him to be my guest, and I wanted to hit that honor of this rock star. But he goes to the scum of the earth, chief tax collector. Zacchaeus stopped and said, this was probably during dinner then, after seeing Jesus just come and just look at him and chat as if he's an old friend. Zacchaeus stopped and said to the Lord, look, I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anyone, I repay them four times as much. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this household, because he too is a son of Abraham. He's not the scum of the earth. He is a beloved child of God. For the human one, the Son of Man, the Messiah, has come to seek and to save the lost. The word of the Lord for us today, thanks be to God. Wow. Friends, it is impossible to make up someone like Jesus. I think the fact, the truth of him being here and alive was the fact that no one could create someone like him, like the one you just heard, because he is the one who did not care at all about being seen as the Messiah by the righteous. He wanted to be seen as the Savior of the tax collectors. I have come to seek and to save the lost. Doesn't that just open up the heart of God to you? It should. Because you will note that Jesus did not, around the dinner table with Zacchaeus, say, well, Zacchaeus, I wanted to have dinner with you so that I can tell you what you need to do to be saved. You must follow the five spiritual laws. You must say these magic words. You must then tithe or give a lot of your money to this, to support the synagogue. He didn't say any of that. What did he say? I just like you a lot, Zacchaeus. I absolutely see the very best in you. I look past the mistakes that we all make, and I'm going to call you my brother. That changed Zacchaeus' heart, and he did what no one else could do. He was so moved by Jesus that he said, I am now accepted as part of the family. Here, I restore all that I have done, and even more, because now I am loved. I have a new life ahead of me. Friends, we all, no matter how righteous or unrighteous we are in our lives as we see ourselves, all at times have been like Sadie, wonderfully free off the leash. We've all made mistakes. But remember, Jesus sees in you that which sometimes you don't see in yourself. You are beloved. You are, of all the creation that's ever been and ever will be, unique and precious. Live that. Stop running away from that particular part in your life and just be able to know that Jesus invites himself over. Here's something you might like to do. Whatever it is in your life that you might feel like you've strayed a bit, you're ignoring a bit, you're trying to do some self-justification about whatever you've done or didn't do that you should have done, just take some devotional time this week, sometime, whenever that is, and you just remember this story from Luke 19. Or you read in Luke 15 about the prodigal son and how God is like that father who waits for that wayward child to what? Come home. And when he sees him, that father runs off the porch to embrace him, not saying, son, what do you have to say for yourself? But I am so glad you're back. You read something like that, and you get in your picture, in your mind, the picture of God being as Jesus had said, that father yearning for the son to come back, that shepherd looking for that one silly little sheep lost in the thicket, or Tim off looking for Sadie. You get that in your mind's eye, and in your prayer, just in the silence, say, Lord, thank you for continuing to seek me. Open my eyes, show me your path, and I will come home. So what did Tim ultimately decide about Sadie? Well, I contacted the upper room, and I said, I love the story, but whatever happened, I like to see the long-term effects of this. So here is a picture of Tim and Sadie. Do we have that? As you can tell, Sadie's grown up and is at home. And this is how Tim ended his devotion. I just hooked the leash on Sadie's collar and rubbed her chin, and together we walked back home. God's love is upon us and is pursuing us, wooing us even before we are aware of it, and all throughout our lives. As the Apostle Paul put it, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I can run from God, and I have on many occasions, yet God still lovingly, patiently pursues me until I run into a corner and come back asking, do you still love me? God's answer is always yes. And how did Zacchaeus' story end? Zacchaeus, come down from there. I want to stay at your house. It's been way too long. Friends, how will your story end? Thank you.
please rise with me as we respond with our Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
We give of our tithes and offerings. Instead of passing the plate, we have them stationed at the back of the church, or you can donate online.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Gracious Jesus, name above all names, giver of life everlasting. Your font of eternal life overflows with blessings for those in need. We give back these offerings to bring joy to your kingdom. Bless these offerings and use these gifts for those in need. In your name we pray. Amen. I do want to remind you, please wait for the ushers to escort you out to keep our social distancing.
Benediction. I have, as you might recall from last time, a beagle hound, Jake the Beagle. Now, if you've ever had a dog with a species that ends in hound, you know it just loves to roam and to get out that door. And we have deer in our subdivision, lots of little deer and big deer. And one time, Jake got loose and chased a deer. His heart was so happy. I was so frustrated. So I got in the car and looked around looking for him. And I saw him in a common area sitting down looking at a deer about 10 feet away that was simply looking back at him. And I could read what my dog's mind was thinking. Now that I got it, what do I do with it? Friends, sometimes when we leave home, when we run away, what we get isn't exactly what we'd expected. Sometimes it's better just to stay home and appreciate the love that you find there. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.